Ignorance about darkness steals from the believer. Matthew 4:16. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. What we don't know will always end up being the devil's inroad to sneak in and steal what is rightfully ours. For instance, sin is not a friend to anyone, but an enemy that wants to hurt the human race, like it did in the beginning to Adam and Eve in the garden. But ignorance is probably one of Satan's well-used weapons. Hosea 4:6 AMP says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge of my law, where I reveal my will. Because you, the priestly nation, have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being my priest. Since you have forgotten the law of your God, I will also forget your children." Also, lack of knowledge holds people captive according to Isaiah 5:13 KJV. "Therefore my people are gone into captivity, because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst." What to know about darkness? Number 1. Darkness is forceful. This is why it is not wise to dabble into anything that the devil offers, whether it has to do with occultism, witchcraft, or sin. Darkness cannot be toyed with, because the adversary that we are contending with is very forceful, and eventually he will leave the individuals with no choice. The question is, why is it so? Revelation 6:3. "When he, the Lamb, broke the second seal, I heard the second living creature call out, 'Come!' And another, a fiery red horse of bloodshed, came out, and its rider was empowered to take peace from the earth, so that men would slaughter one another. And a great sword of war and violent death was given to him." There's a force on the earth, and the scripture calls it a fiery red horse of bloodshed, with the mandate to take peace from the earth and also cause men to kill themselves, foolish killings, with no clear and sensible motives for it. Many young men and women have been forced into groups that forcefully got them to try out hard drugs, and before knew what was happening, they were addicted to those harmful drugs. Many have lured, under the guise of social justice, into terrorism from the loving protection and comfort of their parents' home, and then in no time, they are binding on explosives and walking into suicide missions. They know lives will be lost, but they have gotten to the point of no return, because the force of darkness has taken over. This is also the same way the devil lures young people into prostitution. The promise of fun, money, and beautiful things comes at first, then after these, there is force. Do this or lose your life. Pimps take charge, and before long, that person feels the bondage that darkness always brings. Threats and control are now the way this darkness business will be done. If we look closely, we will see that it is not about the people, but about the spirit behind the scene that is forcefully controlling or manipulating its victims. 2 Peter 2:18. "For uttering arrogant words of vanity, pompous words disguised as sound scholarly or profound, but meaning nothing and containing no spiritual truth, they beguile and lure using lustful desires, by sensuality, those who barely escape from the ones who live in error. They promise them liberty when they themselves are the slaves of depravity. For by whatever anyone is defeated and overcome, to that person, thing, philosophy, or concept, he is continually enslaved. Not all that glitter is gold. Some might just be a trap to capture unsuspecting individuals with the motive of forcing them into one form of sin or the other." Number 2. Darkness is secretive. John 3:19-21. "This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light, and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." Have you ever wondered why a lot of the acts of darkness are not committed in the open? The devil knows that as long as that crime, sin, or evil is not in the open, it possesses more power to replicate and keep it going strong. Because it is against both the ways of God and the laws of the state, he hides it from the light and does it in secret. The devil hates the light and loves secrecy because darkness is his cloak. The heart is deceitful above all things, and it is extremely sick. Who can understand it fully and know its secret motives? I, the Lord, search and examine the mind. I test the heart, to give each man according to his ways, according to the results of his deeds. Jeremiah 17:9. Drug peddlers, human traffickers try to hide as much as they can. Street prostitutes love the cloak of the night. Serial killers don't kill their victims in the open. Conspirators hide their plans from people until it is completely executed. And anytime darkness tries to creep out into public domain to normalize evil, we must vote that it is to recruit other darkness lovers into its destructive web. Psalms 90:8 AMP says, "You have placed our wickedness before you. Our secret sins which we tried to conceal, you have placed in the revealing light of your presence." However, we must know that God sees all things, and we can't hide our sins from Him. Yes, sins may be thought up or executed in the secret, but it is only hidden from men, not from the Creator, before whom all is open. Eventually, the fruits of darkness will ripen for all to see. This is why we must pray that God will search our heart by His Spirit and purge out every wicked motives so that we can truly be free. Psalms 139:23. "Search me thoroughly, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there is any wicked or hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way." We must say this prayer with all sincerity because God sees our shortcomings, and He's the only one that can help us. This is why Hebrews 4:15 AMP said, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize and understand our weaknesses and temptations, but one who has been tempted, knowing exactly how it feels to be human in every respect as we are, yet without committing any sin." Number 3. Darkness is addictive. It takes ground in our lives little by little until the victim is hardened and his conscience becomes dead. A taste of sin, if not renounced, can become a dangerous addiction that people grapple with for the rest of their lives. The serial killer also starts with one victim, and when he succeeds, he moves to the next. Darkness deceives its host that he has succeeded. This is what brings addiction to the things that should belong only to the devil. Obsession to pornography is on the increase, simply because it is now beyond the control of its victim, and it keeps luring the person back for more even when he knows deep down that he should end this lifestyle. It is beyond their control because their spirit is broken. See what the Bible said in Proverbs 18:14 AMP. "The spirit of man sustains him in sickness, but as for the broken spirit, who can bear it?" The dark force behind evil acts first tries to break the spirit of a man, and then makes it lose the strength to fight or resist that temptation. Once that is achieved, then there is no easy way to control actions. It is at this point that people become addicts. But with God, there is always a way of escape and begins with salvation of our soul. 2 Corinthians 5:17 AMP says, "Therefore, if anyone in Christ, that is, grafted in, joined to Him by faith in Him as Savior, he is a new creature, reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. The old things, the previous moral and spiritual condition, have passed away. Behold, new things have come because spiritual awakening brings a new life." Then we constantly study and do the Word of God while praying fervently to break the addiction. This is what the apostle referred to as working out your salvation. Philippians 2:12 AMP says, "So then, my dear ones, just as you have always obeyed my instructions with enthusiasm, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation, that is, cultivate it, bring it to full effect, actively pursue spiritual maturity with awe-inspired fear and trembling, using serious caution and critical self-evaluation to avoid anything that might offend God or discredit the name of Christ." Addiction to the works of darkness can be broken if we submit to the Holy Spirit's power to bring us out of that bondage. Inside us, the power of God's Spirit resides with the power to break the hold of Satan, sin, and darkness off our lives. There is therefore no addiction that can make God's word and power of no effect. Number 4. Darkness is destructive. The aim of Satan is to destroy man on earth and ultimately rob him of eternity with God. Romans 6:23 AMP says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God, that is, His remarkable overwhelming gift of grace to believers, is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Even in the world, certain crimes attract the death penalty. Remember, sin brought spiritual death to Adam and Eve and robbed them of the presence of God. The devil causes us to die to the leading of the Spirit and disconnects us from God. 1 Corinthians 15:56 AMP says, "The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin by which it brings death is the law." Sin is one of the expressions of darkness, is a destroyer of relationships, but spirituality and physically. Sin has the capacity to destroy a marriage, erode the trust that exists between parents and children, destroy business opportunities and business relationships. This is what God says in Proverbs 1:10. "My son, if sinners entice you, do not consent. If they say, 'Come with us,' let us lie in wait to shed blood. Let us ambush the innocent without cause." Number 5. Darkness is deceptive. Whenever God says, "Don't do it," darkness lurks in the shadows to say, "Do it." Genesis 3:1. "Now the serpent was more crafty, subtle, skilled in deceit than any living creature of the field, which the Lord God had made. And the serpent Satan said to the woman, 'Can it really be that God has said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat fruit from the trees of the garden, except the fruit from the tree which is in the middle of the garden. God said, you shall not eat from it nor touch it, otherwise you will die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You certainly will not die, for God knows that on the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened. That is, you will have greater awareness, and you will be like God, knowing the difference between good and evil.' And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was delightful to look at, and a tree to be desired in order to make one wise and insightful, she took some of its fruit and ate it, and she also gave some to her husband with her, and he ate." The devil is still that same master deceiver. He understands the game well enough and knows how to trick people into doing his bidding. He even attempted to deceive Jesus in Luke 4:5. "Then he led Jesus up to a high mountain and displayed before him all the kingdoms of the inhabited earth and their magnificence in the twinkling of an eye. And the devil said to him, 'I will give you all this realm and its glory, its power, its renown, because it has been handed over to me, and I will give it to whomever I wish. Therefore, if you worship before me, it will all be yours.' Jesus replied to him, 'It is written and forever remains written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve only him.'" If the devil tried to trick Jesus, that means he will also try to trick anyone. This is why Jesus asked us to watch and pray in Mark 14:38 AMP. "Keep actively watching and praying, so that you do not come into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Don't give the devil any opportunity to try to deceive you or entice you to fall into sin. Ephesians 4:27 AMP says, "And do not give the devil an opportunity to lead you into sin by holding a grudge or nurturing anger or harboring resentment or cultivating bitterness." Let us pray. Father, thank you for showing me what darkness represents and its motives. Jesus, you are the light of the world, and I choose to live in daily so that darkness will have no part in me. I draw on your wisdom to live above the lies and schemes of darkness. Thank you, my Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.